بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. اللهم لا سهل إلا ما جعلته سهلا، وأنت تجعل الحزن إذا شئت سهلا سهلا. الحمد لله رب العالمين. I thank Allah سبحانه وتعالى first and foremost for making our hearts inclined to coming and listening a little bit about the method and the way of da'wah, of propagation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it's a time well spent, alhamdulillah rabbil alamin. If you think about the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Tirmidhi, when he said yus'alu al-mar'u an arba'a يسأل المرء يوم القيامة أن أربع لا تزول قدم عبد حتى يسأل عن أربعة. A man's feet won't be shifted. In other words, there's nothing happening to him after nothing will happen unless he's been asked about four things. The first one is عن عمره فيما أفناه, his time and his the years Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him, how he spent it. وَعَنْ شَبَابِهِ فِي مَا أَفْنَاهُ, and his youth, how he also spent it, how he made use of his youth. And we spoke last week about the futuwa, which is taken from the word fata. And if you look at the futuwa of the people mentioned in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the word fatan quite frequently in the Quran. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi as-salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to him as a fata. Innahu fatan yadhkuruhu yuqalu lahu Ibrahim. When the people left for the ceremony, he stayed behind and he did what he did with the idols. The people came back and they asked, who is this person who did the idols, who did this to the idols? They said, it's the Fata, referring to Sayyidina Ibrahim, Sayyidina Yusuf. And the stance it took is very, tremendous, to do that in the community, change the idols, to show them they're wrong. When they came back and they saw the idols in that way, it's a form of da'wah, to show people they're wrong, but in a different way. This is Amr bil ma'roof bil yad. It's changing the situation with your hand. If you are competent, you're capable to do so, and there's no harm that will reach you on your from a physical point of view, or people might threaten you to take your money or destroy your honor. If these things are safe, then you can do so. And if you want to. Put your honor, your money, and your own self at risk. That's a high degree, it's a high rank. Islam says, go ahead. So, the futuwa comes out. The shabab, how a person spends his youth, comes out in Sayyidina Ibrahim, in Sayyidina Yusuf, and also the seven sleepers. They were young men who changed the mindset of the people, or tried to change it, and the people did not want to, and they said, no, we're not taking what you are giving us. We are staying on this religion, which was then Islam, known as Christianity, to them Nasraniya. And they fled to a cave, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them an opening. So all of these things are all of these people mentioned are all Shabab. They were all in the prime of their life. So how we spend our youth is very important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us youth so that we may do something with it. Youth doesn't come every single day of your life until you die. Soon it will be taken away. Then we will ask, what have we done with our youth? So this vibrancy mentally, it's there. Leave it for about another 20 years, you'll feel it will disintegrate, become slower. So now is the time to do something with it. For what? For who? For Allah and for Islam, for ourselves in the year after. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he will be asked fi umrihi fi ma afna, in his time, in this life that he's been given, what did he do with it? And then wa an malihi, the third thing is an malihi, about his money, fi ma anfaqa, or min ayna iktasaba wa fi ma anfaqa, where did he gather that money from and how did he spend that money? And we had a money fundraising effort, inshallah ta'ala. And these things are all, you know, points where a person is point scoring, in other words. It's point scoring by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, this is important that we get into that mentality of point scoring. And then lastly, fi jismihi fi ma abla, and his body, what did he do with it? So, I mean, as we sit here, of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look at these actions, and then on top of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask about the sincerity of these actions. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us constant with the propagation, and constant with the seeking of how to fill our times and our moments as youth, inshallah ta'ala. So there's no time wasted, alhamdulillah. So tonight, inshallah ta'ala, after those words, we're going to speak about steadfastness, endurance, and how is it pronounced? Incessant wayfaring. Now, these are all very important points that a da'i should have within him. Endurance together with patience and endurance are synonymous, so to say. Page number 11, yes, I mean, it was probably going to be different there. Yeah. So, it's very important for a da'i, when he calls somebody to Islam, not to expect results immediately. This is what happens with many people when they think, well, I've tried so long with my neighbor, and up till today, there's no result, there's nothing. So I give up. In Islam, there's no giving up when it comes to da'wah, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the ultimate example to that. The way he constantly, under very severe circumstances and conditions, he kept on calling the people to Islam with his state, with his words and with his actions, and this continued under very severe circumstances for a period of 23 years. And a person might think that the 10 years were easier, but the struggle actually increased. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in Mecca, he called people to Islam. It was difficult. His followers were tortured. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was ridiculed. He was exiled. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lost his supporters, his wife, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him tremendously. But after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took him on the Mi'raj, and that is where the turning point came, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made ready to go on the hijrah, to undertake the hijrah to Medina. When he went to Medina, a person thinks, well, things is going to be easier now. But then, Quraysh did not stop the enmity against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they waged war against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which they never did before. The Sahabas had to battle it out with them. But on top of that, there was the munafiqeen, the hypocrites, who constantly pestered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers in the line of da'wah, and constantly created obstacles for them, which created a lot of difficulty for them. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never ever waged war against them, but the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though he knew who they were, they never waged war against them. So how did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam put up with this difficulty, which was actually a disease that grew from inside Islam out, whereas the mushrikun and the non-believers then, they were outright enemies. They showed their hatred and their enmity towards Islam very openly, and the Prophet ﷺ could see it. But the other party, they had a different approach to Islam, of destroying Islam, and that's from the inside out. And the Prophet ﷺ had to bear with them. And any person that's with any act of brain cell alive in his head knows that the greatest amount of sabr a person has to have is against his own kind, against his own human race, not against things or animals, but rather against his own people. And this is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam displayed tremendously and beautifully. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you look in this time in Makkah, how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went all out to bring this message of Islam to his people. We see where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approached people individually. He approached people in a gathering. When he went to the Suq al-Uqad, he called unto the people, "O people," he said, "believe in La ilaha illallah, you will be safe." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approached people individually, and the Prophet sallallahu spoke to them, and all of these methods, it was not easy, because it's always oppositions. This is the point of the lesson today. It's always oppositions. Whenever you go out, whether approaching people, in secret, you'll find an opposition. Whether publicly, you'll find opposition. Like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had his own uncle as an opposition. When he went into the Suq al-Uqad and he called out to the people, "O people, say La ilaha illallah." People didn't know what La ilaha illallah is. There's no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The only thing that they knew was Lat wal-Uzza, and this is the belief of the forefathers, Dinu Aba'ina. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he brought that in, it was a complete slap in the face of not only the idols which they revered and magnified so much in their hearts, but also slap in the faces of his forefathers and their forefathers, which they also spoke about very highly. And here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes with this idea of this one God only, and where is he? He's not to be seen. And you claim yourself to be a prophet. Why are you so tramped upon, and why are you so weak? Why isn't this God helping you? Why is he sending an angel? Because they believed in angels then. They called them the daughters of Allah. Why don't he send an angel to you and help and aid you and assist you and all of these things? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just said, "Well, I'm just here to warn you and to give you glad tidings if you say this and this and this." But he stick to his guns and carried on with the message and gave it over. This was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We see a beautiful qissa about him when he approached the high or the leaders of Quraysh and how he dealt with them, and see what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, how he uses the element of sabr in his da'wah. But let us first read the first paragraph and see where the alim, Shaykh Muhammad Alawi al-Maliki rahimahullah wa nafa'na bihi wa bikum, where he takes us, inshaAllah ta'ala. He says, "They come upon the early Muslims the toughest trials and the greatest difficulties, and these they faced with patience and refusal to despair, to be disturbed." Now obviously, if a person hear the word "the toughest trials," smile, is it off?
I think so. Matt, come on again, I'll turn
it off. No. The toughest trials, obviously, when a person look at the time, the period of Makkah, there's a great message for us now in this period now. A great message for us in there. And a person thinks sometimes, subhanAllah, why are we so weak? Why is the Muslims not standing up? Why aren't they not doing anything, against the injustice and against, you know, the non-belief in the demonic ideologies going on in all the different concepts, it's anti-Islamic and so on. Why can't we do anything physical? Why can't we do something? But this is the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know. This is the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to awaken the Muslims within. And it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's divine plan to say that, yani, أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا. Did people think that they will be left alone? أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَن يُتْرَكُوا أَن يَقُولُ آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. Did the people think that they will be left alone whilst they're going to say, we believe in Allah and His Messenger, وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ, and they think they will be left alone without being tested and tried? Is this what they think? No, they will be tested. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we tested those who came before them, and so we will test them in the same manner. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to make those who are facing this difficulty in the line of da'wah rise from one degree to another and closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the rising up in degree, it is the effectiveness that grows from the da'i onto the people who he calls to Islam. Sometimes it might be verbally, like we said, sometimes it might be physically, and sometimes it might be just mere state that speaks, and sometimes mere state speaks louder than anything else. Now, so the alim says, indeed, their energy increased and their efforts continued unabated, steady in endurance and steadfastness. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam displayed that in the qissa that I want to read out to you. It's a beautiful qissa. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was called by the leaders of Quraysh, and this was a great opportunity for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to really make the impact, because if he get them over onto the deen, and then that would mean that, you know, everybody else will fall in because they were the leaders. And you know, the da'i sometimes he thinks he's on the right path when he's got the main guy in control, so everybody will follow. Maybe the father is the one that he's targeting, and then, you know, after a few months he thinks, well, this is the right target, and when I get him to embrace Islam, his family will follow and so on. But it's hardly like this, you know. It's hardly like this. Sometimes the one that you are targeting might not be the one that will embrace Islam, but there will be somebody else on the sideline listening, paying attention, giving some sideline glances, and being shy to come into the conversation. And he's the one that's being affected. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam experienced something like this, and it's a mark and a sign for every da'i to come afterwards to know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives guidance. All that we need to do is mention the word and explain it and clear it in clarity and give it over with sincerity and leave everything up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end of the day. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approached the leaders at the time, and it was Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktoum who came to him asking him about a few things about Islam. And he was a blind man, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not feel that it was appropriate for him to come at this particular point to ask him questions, you know, which are not, according to him, important. Now he's sitting with the leaders of Quraysh discussing with him issues about the deen. And it's an opportunity, a golden opportunity, to make the whole of Quraysh enter into Islam, which is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's desire. So he frowned at him, alayhi as-salatu wasalam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in the Quran as a sign that we don't know what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's guidance is pointing towards. It might point towards Abdullah ibn Umm Maktoum more than those leaders. The message is that we need to just give over what Islam wants us to give over, and that is the kalima and the aqidah of Islam, and leave it at that. And afterwards, we'll see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow things to develop. Now here, beautiful qissa related by Ibn Jarir and Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, something similar. It's a long qissa, but there's a lot of lessons to learn out of this qissa. And the people that turned up or called the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is after he went in full force into da'wah, secretively and publicly. This is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, you know, وَانْذُرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقَرَبِينَ, stand up and warn your close relatives. And this is where da'wah starts at the end of the day. So the following people called him: Al-Aswad ibn Abd al-Muttalib ibn Asad, Wal-Zum'a ibn al-Aswad, Wal-Walid ibn Mughira, Wa Aba Jahl ibn Hisham, Wa Abdullah ibn Abi Umayyah. These names might ring a bell to you, some of them. Wa Umayyah ibn Khalaf, Wa Al-Aas ibn Wa'il, Wa Munabihan Wa Munabihan ونبيها ومنبها ابن الحجاج السمهييني. Now these are the people that were leaders of the Quraysh. اجتمعوا, they came together after the sun had set, according to the hadith, عند ظهر الكعبة, at the one of the walls of the Kaaba. فَقَالَ بَعْضُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ, and some of them said to one another, let's call Muhammad صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, فَكَلِّمُوهُ, and then we'll speak to him. This is the time. Everything, you know, he changed everything. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم's da'wah became an upsetting issue in Makkah. The whole Makkah spoke about it. And the leaders couldn't take it anymore, and they had to approach Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَخَاصِمُوهُ حَتَّى تَعْذِرُوا فِيهِ فَبَعَثُوا إِلَيْهِ إِنَّ أَشْرَفَ قَوْمِكَ قَدْ اجْتَمَعُوا لَكَ لِيُكَلِّمُوكَ. And then they said, well, go to him, speak to him, and you know, ask him that أَشْرَفُ قَوْمِكَ, that the leaders of your tribe, of your people, they gathered together and they are sending for you to speak to you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, mashallah, good thing, let's go. فَجَاءَهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, and he came to him sari'an, with enthusiasm, you know. He was excited for this moment. وَهُوَ يَظُنُّ أَنَّهُ قَدْ بَدَى لَهُمْ فِي أَمْرِهِ بَدَاءً وَكَانَ عَلَيْهِمْ وكان عليهم حريصا يحث رشدهم ويعز عليهم عنتهم. يعني the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he was always concerned about their states. Let me speak to them first, let me infiltrate them first, and let me enter into their hearts first, because they are the main targets. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم felt very happy when they called him, because he was always keen on guiding them first. حتى جلس إليهم, until he came to him and sat with him. فقالوا يا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم, he came and sat with him and they said, oh Muhammad, إنا قد بعثنا إليك لنعذر فيك وإنا والله ما نعلم رجلا من العرب أدخل على قومه ما أدخلت على قومك. He says, we have sent for you and we asked for you to come, because we, by Allah, they swear, we don't know any man that has caused to your people what you have caused to his people what you have caused to your people. They said, لَقَدْ شَتَّمْتَ الْآبَاءِ, you have You have Shatama is to any swear? You swore at your forefathers. Wa'idda deen. Ibta means you found fault in the deen of your forefathers. This is what they told you. وَسَفَّهْتَ الْأَحْكَامِ And you have made the rules of Quraysh. You've ridiculed it. سَفَهَا You've ridiculed it. نعم. وَشَتَّمْتَ الْآلِيَا And you swore at the idols. وفرقت الجماعة and you divided the community. You divided the community. فما بقي من قبيح إلا وقد جئته فيما بيننا وبينك. And there's no قبيح, there's no ugliness except that you brought it and you caused it amongst our people. SubhanAllah, this is what they said to him. فإن كنت إنما جئت بهذا الحديث تطلب به مالا Jama'na, they said to him, if you came with all of this with the intention to seek money, we'll give it to you. We'll gather it and we'll give it to you. Naam. Hatta takuna aktharana malan, until you become the most richest from amongst us. Wa in kunta innama tatlubu sharafa fina sawadnaka alayna. And if you seek leadership, then we'll make you the leader of us. This is what they offered the Prophet ﷺ when he started with his da'wah. Now, sometimes you get physical opposition, but bribery to this scale, you have to have sabr for this one. For physical opposition, it's easy. No? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the people. You know, they say that people has gathered for you to destroy you, to harm you. The ayah, I forgot the ayah, it goes. Anybody remember the ayah? قَالُوا حَزْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ إِنَّ قَوْمًا قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the people was told of the Sahaba that another people gathered to harm you and to destroy you. What happened? فَزَادَهُمْ إِمَانًا This is physical opposition. People wanting to destroy you. You become more stronger. But when people throw in your face status, money, this requires a different level of sabr and a different level of endurance. It's not easy to refuse something like this. No, and this is where many ulama fell into the trap of becoming government ulama. If you look throughout the books of akhlaq, you'll find that the scholars always warned against taking from scholars that had taken the funds from governments and leaders, because they have to submit to these leaders at the end of the day and listen to what they say instead of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasul say. So this is, it requires a different sabr altogether. Now says wa in kunta turidu Milkan Malaknaka Amwalana Malaknaka Alaina. And if you want milk or possession or mulk rather, if you want to be king, we make you king over us. This is the impact the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's da'wah had on the people of Quraysh. He was open, and his sincerity was even a bigger force behind it, because they saw that all the torture is not helping, and all of their alienation is not helping. Nothing is working. You know, the people are just growing and increasing. So they gave this to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَإِنْ كَانَ هَذَا الَّذِي يَأْتِيكَ بِمَا يَأْتِيكَ رِئِيًا تَرَاهُ قَدْ غَلَبَ عَلَيْكَ وَكَانُوا يَسَمَّونَ نَعْمَ And they even thought that the Prophet ﷺ was afflicted by jinn. And a ri'yan is they call a person a ri'yan when he is afflicted by a jinn. And then when he becomes insane and he do things which becomes, you know, abnormal in society. Just shows how normal people thought of, yani, according to them, normality was like this. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's display of character was completely abnormal in the eyes, which is the norm. And when you find yourself adapting to Islam to the degree where people say you are abnormal, then you are on the right path. Then you're on the right path. And there's a hadith to the effect that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Udhkurullah hatta yadhunnunaka majnunan." Or yaqulu annaka majnun. Carry on with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until people will call you that you are insane. Or say you are insane because of the intenseness of your remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is something which can obviously be of different kinds. Remembrance is not confined only to your subha or to qira'atul Qur'an and so on, but it's a very vast, you know, the scope of remembrance is very vast. Any person that's constantly engaged with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this person is remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though he is in the souq, selling, you know, buying and selling. Is like they asked one of the sufis, I think it was Ibrahim ibn Adham, he asked, what is the most strangest thing that you've ever seen, or the strangest thing you've ever seen? He said, when I went to Makkatul Mukarrama and I made tawaf around the Kaaba, I saw an old man hanging on the Kaaba, asking for the dunya. And then I left the haram and I went out into the souq, and I saw a young man buying and selling to females, but his tongue was wet with the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I've never seen such a strange thing before. The older person gets, the closer his heart grows to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and further it goes away from the dunya. But this is something tremendous, and this old man was in front of the Kaaba on top of it. The point where your person can't separate oneself, whether he wants to, away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the souq is a place that you can't separate yourself from the dunya, even if you want to. It's there, it's constantly calling you. And here's a young man in the souq, and an old man at that place, the Kaaba, yet they have two different, you know, mentalities and different outlooks. And this is the most strangest thing. So remembrance is not only confined to that, but it's really the state that the person is in. Can be in the soul, can be anywhere. So they said the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you might have been afflicted by jinn. Let us, you know, فَرُبَّمَا كَانَ ذَاكَ بَذَلْنَا أَمْوَالَنَا فِي طَلَبِ الطِّبِّ. We will spend our money, they say, to get you the best doctor, to get you out of the state. حَتَّى نُبْرِئُكَ, until we cure you. SubhanAllah. And they said this to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we know they said it because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. No, they said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is majnoon. No. أو نعذرا فيك. فقال رسول sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu, this is the response of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, ما بي ما تقولون. He says, first of all, whatever you say did not happen to me. مَا جِئْتُكُمْ بِمَا جِئْتُكُمْ بِهِ. Whatever I came to you with, I came to you with. أَطْلُبُ أَمْوَالَكْ. مَا جِئْتُكُمْ بِهِ أَطْلُبُ أَمْوَالَكْ. Whatever I came with, I didn't come with it to get your money. وَلَا الشَّرَفَ, and not status or leadership. وَلَا الْمُلْكِ, and not kingdom. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ بَعَثَنِي إِلَيْكُمْ رَسُولًا. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send me to you a messenger. وَأَنْزَلَ عَلَيَّ كِتَابًا, and he's revealed upon me a book. وَأَمَرَنِي أَنْ أَكُونَ لَكُمْ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا, and he ordered me to be a source of glad tidings to you and a source of warning unto you. فَبَلَّغْتُكُمْ رِسَالَاتِ رَبِّي, and I have spoken to you the رِسَالَات, you know, the messages of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَنَصَّحْتُ لَكُمْ, and I advised you. فَإِن تَقْبَلُوا مِنِّي, and if you accept from me مَا جِئْتُكُمْ بِهِ, what I've given to you, فَهُوَ حَظُّكُمْ, and that's your gain فِي الدُّنْيَا and in the آخِرَة. وَإِن تَرُدُّوهُ عَلَيَّ, And if you refuse to take this from me, what was his answer? Asbir. Asbir li amrillah. I'll be patient for the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hatta yahkum Allahu bayni wa baynakum, until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will see what is right between me and you. So the word asbir, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used here, is a mark of a da'i to show that whatever happens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the one that the tests. It's not you who punish me, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us. And how many times are we tested in the line of da'wah, and then we say, for example, like the people who said in the Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has recorded this in the Quran, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا وَإِذَا أُوذِيَ فِي اللَّهِ جَعَلَ فِتْنَةَ النَّاسِ كَعَذَابِ اللَّهِ. Subhanallah, yani, when people say, we believe, O Rasulullah, we believe, O Allah, we are mu'mineen, يَقُولُونَ آمَنَّا وَإِذَا أُوذِيَ, and when they are harmed in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they treat the opposition of men as though it were the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As though it is the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And strictly speaking, sometimes, you know, it is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending a punishment, but it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala training the nufus of the mu'mineen to raise higher. And this is why it went on for 13 years in Makkah in comparison to the 10 years when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had his own establishment and his own state, went in more, the difficulties carried on more, the insecurity carried on longer in Makkah than in Medina. There was security, but there was also difficulties that they had to put up with. The reason for that was to instill the element of sabr in the hearts of the Sahaba, because of the big struggle or the big responsibility that will rest squarely upon their shoulders after the Meccan period, when they go to Medina, from that state, that Islamic state, from there will rise people that will have to carry this message onto different areas in Arabia and then further on. And they required a great amount of sabr. And here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in simple terms, he said, "Asbir li amri Allah hatta yahkum Allahu baynana wa baynakum." I'll just be patient until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala see what is right between the two of us. Then they said, "Kama qala Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam." Faqalu ya Muhammad, and then they said, "O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wasallam, fa'in kunta ghayra qabilin minna ma aradna alayka, if you want to take what we are offering you, فَقَدْ عَلِمْتَ أَنَّهُ لَيْسَ أَحَدٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ أَضْيَقَ مِنَّا بِلَادًا وَلَا أَقَلَّ مَالًا وَلَا أَشَدَّ عَيْشًا مِنَّا. So they said to him, so if you want to take anything from us, let us then see what you've got to give to us. There's nothing, there's nobody in this valley called Makkah that, yani, that has this diq, this tightness. What they're speaking about is geographically, the way Makkah is situated is in a very dry area, surrounded with mountains, black mountains, very dark mountains. There's no greenery, there's no rivers, there's nothing. So they said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's nobody that has this tightness geographically than us. وَلَا أَقَلَّ مَالًا, and there's nobody that has less money than us. وَلَا أَشَدَّ عَيْشًا مِنَّا, there's no one that lives a more difficult and harsher life than us. The Bedouin Arabs, the Meccan Arabs, they lived a difficult life. Now, they had to travel to bring in goods and fruit and all sorts of things. They had to travel, and then it was a very hard life. They had camels and so on, but other people had much more than that. Camels and much more. فَسَأَلَ فاسأل لنا ربك. So ask for us your Lord الذي بعثك بما بعثك به. So ask your Lord, the one who sent you. They ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فليسر عنا هذه الجبال. Ask your Lord, the one who sent you, to widen up the space for us. Push these mountains aside so that we can have some breathe. حتى التي قد ضيقت علينا. These mountains that, you know, that clouded us. وليبسط لنا بلادنا. And so that he may flat our lands. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa speaks in the Quran about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the earth a mihad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in many places in the Quran where he made madadana al-arda. Certain ayahs that comes to my mind, freakers in my mind, but I can't get the complete one. In Surah Nuh, in Surah Balad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions how he flattened the earth for mankind. And in that flattening is a tremendous ease. We just don't realize it. We just don't realize it. If there wasn't the technology today, the technology that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent us, then traveling would have been an extremely, extremely difficult task. And this is what the Arabs went through. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks frequently about the flatness of the earth so that they can realize the ease that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made for them. It's in certain areas. So they had certain routes that they used to take. And if it wasn't for this route that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them, they wouldn't have been able to do anything apart from climb mountains. And climbing mountains, they can't go with their family, they can't go with their goods, they can't make trade, and which is their source of income, trade, their time. So they wanted this. وَلْيُفْجِرْ فِيهَا أَنْهَارَ كَأَنْهَارِ الشَّامِ وَالْعِرَاقِ. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to let the rivers flow in Makkah, like it flows in Sham and in Iraq. وَلْيَبْعَثْ لَنَا مَنْ مَضَى مِنْ آبَائِنَا وَلْيَكُنْ فِي مَنْ يُبْعَثْ لَنَا مِنْهُمْ قُصَيْ ibn كِلَاب. And they ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ask your Lord to bring forth our forefathers from their graves. So, and from amongst them, ask him to bring forth Qusay ibn Kilab, who was one of the forefathers that was known for wisdom. فَإِنَّهُ كَانَ شَيْخًا صَدُوقًا. Because he was a shaykh, saduq, he was a truthful shaykh. A shaykh is somebody that has reached a very high level of wisdom, literally speaking, from the Arabic language. Person who attained a level of wiseness, of wisdom, that he were allowed to speak in any circumstances. So they wanted to bring Qusay up. فَنَسْأَلْهُمْ عَمَّا تَقُولُ أَحَقٌ هُوَ أَمْ بَاطِلٌ. And we will ask them then to assist whether what you saying is true and beneficial for us. Look at the tactics that they use. فَإِنْ صَنَعْتَ مَا سَأَلْنَاكَ وَصَدَّقُوكَ وَصَدَّقْنَاكَ. And if you do that for us and they affirm that you are speaking the truth, we will believe in you. وَعَرَّفْنَا بِهِ مَنْزِلَتَكَ. And then we will know your manzila, your status, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen for you, and your manzila by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَنَّهُ بَعْثَكَ رَسُولًا. And that he has sent you a messenger, كَمَا تَقُولُ, that like you say. فَقَالَ لَهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم's answer to them was, مَا بِهَذَا بُعِثْتُ. I was not sent for this. It's another sign for the da'i to take in. Sometimes the da'i says, oh, a miracle would do quite good now. And anyway, why can Allah send a sign? But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sayyidul Khalq, the miracles were at his fingertips, on the tips of his lips and his tongue. He could have just uttered it and could have come out. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, ما بعثنا ما بهذا بعثت. Not for this I have sinned. To show you miracles, you know. To show you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the power that can do this to you. إِنَّمَا جِئْتُكُمْ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ بِمَا بَعَثَنِي بِهِ. I came to you from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or with what with that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent me with. This is what I came. And I'm just speaking and I'm just, you know, sharing it with you verbally. How? Verbally, physically, and through my state, this is how I'm sharing it with you. فَقَدْ بَلَّغْتُكُمْ. I have informed you about what this message is all about. مَا أُرْسِلْتُ بِهِ إِلَيْكُمْ. What I've been sent with to you. فَإِن تَقْبَلُوهُ. And if you take it, فَهُوَ حَظُّكُمْ. If you take it, this will be your gain. فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. In the dunya and in the akhirah. وَإِن تَرُدُّوهُ. And if you refuse it, what did he say? عَلَيَّ الصَّبْرُ. وعلي الصبر علي أصبر وإن ترده علي أصبر لأمر الله حتى يحكم الله بيني وبينكم. I'll just be patient until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will decide between us. If a person look at this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam repeated the same answer. He repeated the same answer. There is nothing that a da'i should be shy of to hide when he speaks da'wah or when he speaks about Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in front of the leaders of Quraysh, the people that hated him the most, if they were to cool their hatred for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the rest of the people would cool it as well. But the rest of the followers of the leaders of Quraysh, they took up the stance because they were very, the enmity was great against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the Prophet ﷺ did not change his method or his tune. He did not accept anything from them in return for what they offered. The Prophet ﷺ continued to say, this is what I was sent with. This is Islam. It's clear, black and white. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent me with. Take it or leave it. This is the akhlaq of a da'i. And not to become sentimental, but become emotionally affected and perturbed by the responses of people. This is the mark of a da'i. If a person gives over a message, give it over as if you have 100, as not as if, but this is the amount of yaqeen that we need to have with our deen. Give it over as if this is the only answer for today. It is the only answer for today now, without a doubt. No, it is the only answer for today. And it will continue to be the only answer for people until the end of time. Then they said, فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلْ لَنَا هَذَا. And if you're not going to do this for us, which we asked you to do, because you've just said now, well, you've not been sent for this, فَخُذْ لِنَفْسِكَ فَسَلْ رَبَّنَا أَن يَبْعَثَ مَلَكًا يُصَدِّقُكَ بِمَا تَقُولُ. And then if you don't take this, then ask your Lord then to send you an angel to come down and to tell us that this what you are saying is true. بِمَا تَقُولُ وَيُرَاجِعُنَا عَنْكَ وَتَسْأَلْهُ. And then he will come to us and tell us, وَتَسْأَلْهُ فَيَجْعَلْ لَكَ جَنَّاتٍ وَكُنُوزًا وَقُصُورًا مِنْ ذَهَبٍ وَفِضَّةٍ. نعم. وَيُهْنِيكَ بِهَا عَمَّا نَرَاكَ تَبْتَغِي فَإِنَّكَ تَقُومُ بِالْأَسْوَاقِ. And let this angel then, through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, make you independent of us. Let him bring forth for you the treasures of the earth. Let him build you castles and palaces of silver and gold and silver. And let him make you independent of need of us. يُغْنِيكَ بِهَا عَمَّا نَرَاكَ تَبْغِي, or make you independent of what we see you are hasting, you know, are holding on. Like, for example, the trade that you are doing of Khadija, why are you doing that? Why can't you just have an angel and you call yourself a prophet? Why can't you just have all this ease that prophet should have, according to their minds? فَإِنَّكَ تَقُومُ بِالْأَسْوَاقِ, you are standing in the aswaq, in the marketplaces, they say to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَتَلْتَمِسُ الْمَعَاشِ, and you are trying to earn a livelihood like all of us. كَمَا نَلْتَمِسُ, like we do. حَتَّى نَعْرِفْ فَضْلَ مَنْزِلَكَ, until we know. So let this angel come and show this to us so that we can understand what is your manzila, your rank by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِن كُنْتَ رَسُولًا كَمَا تَزْعُمْ, if you are really a messenger like you are claiming to be. The answer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to this one was, فَقَالَ لَهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَسَلَّمُ مَا أَنَا بِفَاعِلٍ, I'm not doing that. مَا أَنَا بِالَّذِي يَسْأَلْ رَبَّهُ هَذَا, I'm not asking my Lord this. وَمَا بُعِثْتَ إِلَيْكُمْ بِهَذَا, وَمَا بُعِثْتُ إِلَيْكُمْ بِهَذَا, and I've not been sent to you for this. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ بَعَثَنِي بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا, however Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send me a bashir wa nadir, a person who gives glad tidings and a person who warns. فَإِنْ تَقْبَلُوا مَا جِئْتُكُمْ بِهِ, and if you were to accept, or if you accept what I came to you with from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then that's your gain in the dunya and the akhirah. وَإِنْ تَرُدُّوهُ عَلَيَّ, and if you refuse it, asbir, I'll be patient. So there's absolutely no way that they could perturb the yaqeen of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the message of Islam. And because of that yaqeen that he has, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had that sabr to put up with everything that was thrown into his face of difficulties. And this yaqeen, it is the seed of sabr. As Sayyidina Abdullah al-Haddad mentions in one of the books that he authored, that yaqeen or sabr is of three kinds. He relates the words of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas when he was asked, did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speak about sabr in the Quran? He says, yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about sabr in the Quran, and sabr is mentioned in the Quran. The sabr mentioned in the Quran are of three types. The first one is as-sabr ala ta'a, to have patience on executing the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the manner Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to practice it and to show it. The second type of sabr is as-sabr anil ma'asi, is to have patience on staying away from everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited. Everything. This requires a greater sort of patience and endurance. And then the third degree of sabr is as-sabr ala qada'i Allahi wa qadrihi, is to have patience on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's decree. Were he to make you the poorest person now, then you will have patience. Or were he to make you the illest person now, then he had patience. Whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does with one is in complete satisfaction with his decision. And this is the highest degree of sabr. And Imam Ghazali says, and this last one is not given except if the person has yaqeen to support that amount of sabr. And this yaqeen together with the sabr was fixed in the heart of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nobody could turn it around, left or right, up or down. It was firm, it was fixed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw the trials coming to him. But like people, some people who see the trials coming upon them in the line of da'wah, they look at it as the adab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a punishment. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't look at it as an adab from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, he looked at those people who punished him as not an enemy, but rather as people that need guidance, not as an enemy, but rather as people that are doing good to him. And we need to go back quickly to the words of Sheikh Muhammad Alawi al-Malikin to get that picture right in our minds, inshallah ta'ala. So he says, they came out of these tough tests, however extreme they were, and their society emerged as strong as any society can ever hope to be with regard to this young man and woman. Their experience grew and their readiness to face the external challenges confronting them became wider in scope. For 11 years, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam remained persistent in his jihad with unswerving patience. He endured estrangement, alienation from his people and his neighbors, such that his life became completely unsettled, devoid of rest. The Quraysh, however, remained vigilant at all times, looking for the chance to kill him. And yet he was patient and self-accounting, dutiful, and sincerely advising his people. His patience, that of the man whose heart is filled with immense hope. This saved him from leaving his struggle and led him to actualize its implication and reach its limits. His resolution did not weaken, nor his strength fail for even a day. The result was that the obstacles fell away when faced with his strength and aspiration, and the trials and difficulties became as nothing before his determination and his patience. This is what happens when you've got that yaqeen. So a da'i doesn't need to despair. There's no despair with a da'i. إِنَّهُ مَنْ يَيْأَسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ لَا يَيْأَسُ مِنْ رَوْحِ اللَّهِ إِلَّا الْقَوْمُ الْكَافِرُونَ. Nobody despairs in the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wherever it may lie, except the people of unbelief. So this is something which is not to be found in a da'i at all times. He's always on high with regard to his yaqeen, with his presence with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with his love for the deen. Sometimes he might do something which is opposite of the deen, but with the intention opposite that the deen teaches, but we call that hikmah to da'wah, or yani siyasa to da'wah, the politics of da'wah, how to treat certain situations in a specific manner, not to step out of line of the sharia, but rather to accommodate for the weaknesses of the people that he's calling to Islam. But never does a da'i step out of this high. Never. So when others would have prayed for Quraysh to be wiped out, he prayed, alayhi as-salatu wasalam, not against them. This is what I meant. But for them. He prayed for them. How many times do we find people praying against our leaders? So many times we pray against them. But the adab of a da'i is rather to pray for them. He prayed that they be guided and made excuses for them on grounds of ignorance when he said, "Oh Allah, my people, surely they know not what they do." This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam frequently mentioned. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also said in the hadith, I think related by Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, "It is as if I see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam now saying and mentioning a prophet of the previous nations. كان قومه يضربونه بالحجار. His people threw him with stones until he bled. And when until he bled." Similarly to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went through. But this is a prophet of previous nations, and his answer was, "Allahumma ighfir lahum fa innahum la ya'lamun." Oh Allah, forgive them, for they know not. This is the approach of a da'i. Why? Because we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a da'i, we should know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy is immense. And we should not tell people they are wrong, or we don't have the right to tell people they are wrong in what they do, if we have not given them the message yet, or ridicule them behind their backs, especially when they have not understood the message of Islam. And through Aqidah, you know, one of the great scholars of Aqidah, Abu Ishaq al-Isfarahini, some of you might know him, Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari and others, they said, وَمَا كُنَّ مُعَدَّ they said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it's just flickers in my mind, اللهم صلي على سيدنا محمد وما كنا is a Quran over there. I don't know where in the Quran that ayah is, to be honest. إن الله وما كنا معذب قوما حتى نبعث رسولا اللهم صلي على سيدنا. We were not to punish a people until we send a messenger to them. This is the meaning of the ayah. And from that ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we will not punish you until we have sent you information on, about how to believe in me and how to practice as a Muslim, live a life as a Muslim. And until you've not received that message, whether that may be through a messenger, whether that may be through after the time of a messenger, through some of the followers of this particular messenger, if that message did not reach you, then we will not punish you. And there are many people today that so many people that has a distorted concept of Islam, yet we are quick to ridicule them or to put them down because they don't see the haq in the light, and it's not supposed to be like that. But rather we should have a constant dua for them after our salahs, especially those who are close to us, our neighbors. Sometimes they might be relatives, maybe not much here in England. We tend to stick to our own, but nowadays it happens, you know, third, second generation, they're marrying outside, across the board, so on, and their relatives are non-Muslim. So we have to have a constant dua for them, and this is part of our way of approaching the propagation or the spreading of the message of Islam in a different way. Well, where do we find it? We find it with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had this patience, even though he knew they were in the wrong, he would deal with this matter in an anti-aggression way. There was the people of Najran, they were Christian, and they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to ask about Islam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's approach to them was, "You're welcome, here's my mosque." And they slept in the mosque, fed them, they slept there, fed them, and he looked after them. Then it was Sunday, they needed a place to worship and do their Sunday sermon. "Here's my mosque." So they did their sermon in the mosque. And after they spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet spoke to them, they did not accept Islam and they left. he did not wage war against them or become aggressive towards them, even though he knew these were Ahlul Kitab, they were Nasara. And they knew that he, alayhi as-salatu wasalam, was mentioned in their books, it was mentioned in their discussion. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam left them to go away without having embraced Islam. What patience is this? And when a person speaks to people, we be very clear about Islam, but we don't expect from them immediate responses until the message comes clear, brisk clear to them. Then it is a complete different story altogether. But even though the element of physical jihad requires a state to initiate it, we know that. So if we're going to go into that line, it's going to cause a great deal of misunderstanding on how we should approach da'wah. Whereas da'wah should nowadays be more concentrated on our individual, own individual actions that we do on a daily basis between our neighbors, no matter who they are, the one sitting next to us in class, the one that we're dealing with over the counter, the whatever. Now this is the approach that we need to have, or else we will fail, because this is the type of approach that is hardly seen. The only approach that we normally see is where the public are addressed by a speaker, and on this basis when people listen and they hear and they do enter into Islam, yes, but what if every single Muslim becomes an embodiment of the way of the or the method of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam's method of da'wah, and the way we leave them, or the message that we leave them with, is very simple. We just tell them to believe in La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Now that is the message that we need to bring across to them. And I'm going to read further on, and yes, some more issues of patience, you know. So when others, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would make an excuse for them, and when Jibreel placed upon him peace be upon him, offered to destroy them, he expressed his hope for them, saying, "Indeed, I hope that Allah will bring forth from their loins a people who will worship Allah, great and glorious alone, associating nothing with Him, as has come to us in the sound hadith." Now, the incident of Taif. Now, there's nothing greater than that incident. You know, this is one of the stories of great inspiration to for a da'i to see what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went through in that particular instance, and this experience that he had physically and emotional rejection when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lost his wife and then his uncle in that year, and his own people rejected him and alienated him. He took the message with full, you know, enthusiasm to the people of Taif, and he got that very harsh rejection from them, where he felt it emotionally and physically. And his dua was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will eventually perhaps place in the hearts of these people something to say that will lead them to say La ilaha illallah. So the da'i, when it comes to the people, he might have this beautiful way of approaching them, but he does not have a hope that that person become Muslim. Well, my business is just to give the verbal part, and that's it. Yes, it's true, but you have to be emotionally linked with that state of that person, because as a Muslim, you know that a person who does not believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or in the message of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, the way we believe, is not going to be of the people of the Jannah. And the people of the Jannah or Jannah will ask the people of the Jahannam, مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ. What caused you to be in the Saqar? What is the Saqar? It's one of the names of Jahannam. What do they say? قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُوا مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. We did not make salah. Well, strange. You know, all of these kufa, all of these non-believers in the Jahannam, they didn't, you know, is it because they didn't make salah? Were they commanded to make salah on the earth by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though they didn't believe in Islam? By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the commands of the Sharia, it's incumbent upon the Muslims to follow, like it is incumbent upon the Muslims to follow them, it's incumbent upon the non-Muslims to follow them. But it's not our duty to demand it from them. But it's Allah's duty to demand it from them, isn't it? He is their Lord at the end of the day. So this difficulty that they will go through in the year after should be in our heart. It should be a fear that we fear, something that we fear just as much as they would fear it if they were to know what was awaiting for them. So it's important for us to look at things this way. To have that hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may change them. A hope. And with that hope comes a dua. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had his hopes always that he wanted, things that he yearned and wanted to see, he always made dua for them. He further informed us about himself when he said, I have suffered in the way of Allah what no one else has suffered, and have been terrorized for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ways that no one else has. There has come upon Bilal and I 30 days when there was nothing more for anyone with a stomach to eat than that which could be hidden in Bilal's or under Bilal's armpit. And it's just the expression of how little there was available for them to eat. Yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's da'wah was not stopped. It carried on. And this is a great example to use for modern day da'is. You know, where we have langar upon langar, and feast upon feast, and mefal upon mefal, and all of these things. It's not inconsistent with the way of a da'i. You know, and if there's no langar, there's no da'i. You don't have food at an event, there's nothing. People don't come and listen. If there's no feast, people are not interested. There has to be some sort of incentive. And this is the only way that we have to get people over nowadays. And it's a shame. Or the du'a are not aspired to do anything unless there's a reward out. And this is all of the weaknesses that we need to withdraw from, and see that in there lies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure, and in there lies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's reward and his acceptance. And this is the thing that should draw us to carry on with the da'wah. Now, the faithful were also greatly attested the day of the Confederates. The day the Confederates gathered against them, and they were severely shaken as they had no previously encountered an army as numerous as this. But the divine guidance came down in Allah's address to the Holy Messenger. Now, this is also when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also made da'wah to the non-believers in all of his battles. Was all forms of da'wah. As a matter of fact, jihad is da'wah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always told his sahaba when they went out to call the people for 3 days to Islam, and if they were to accept Islam, and then we have to separate the men from the family and from the woman and the children, and put them on the safe side, and address the men on the battlefield. This is how it used to be in those days. Now, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam always encouraged da'wah at the beginning. And in this jihad of the when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met up with the opponents, it was also a stance of patience, where patience were displayed and displayed in a very, very very high on a very high degree. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Prophet, fear Allah and obey not the non-believers or the disbelievers and the hypocrites. Certainly Allah is knowing, is all-knowing, or is knowing, wise. Follow what is revealed to you from your Lord. Indeed, Allah is fully aware of what you are doing. And trust in Allah. Sufficient is Allah as a guardian. And like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking to every single da'i. To every single da'i. So when we speak out, and there's nothing speaking out, and there's no amun speaking out the haq today, and unless it's considered of those words that might cause or words that's incentive towards different types of hatred, religious hatred, racial hatred, and these type of things, obviously. A person have to respect it, and that's part of Islam at the end of the day. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran, you know, don't ridicule another people, and then they end up ridiculing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then you were the cause of all this ridicule that happened to against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or racial, of course, this is something which is completely haram in Islam, the first and the second. So a person keep one's low. But when a person speak out against an injustice, is this allowed? Yes, it is. It's always allowed. It should always be injustice should always be lowered. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam considered this speaking out the truth as the jihad. As the jihad, when he said, أعظم الجهاد, the greatest jihad, كلمة حق عند سلطان جائر, the greatest jihad is a word of truth you mention, you speak against a tyrant ruler. A tyrant ruler. This is the jihad. Many people feel the jihad should be the physical jihad where you do physical damage to the opposition, but this is not really what this jihad was considered to be real jihad. No, this is a form of jihad, but not the real jihad. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also praises those who speak out against injustice. Speak out against injustice has always been done in any country, if a person do it in the proper manner, without incentives. No. It can be seen that the Quran has ordered him, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with three things. Now in this ayah, there's three things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the Prophet to with. The first one is that he fear Allah alone. Da'i should always fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Now, and that he neither fear the enemies nor obey or surrender to them. This is the second one. Many a times a person compromises the deen, and this is not what a da'i should do. We should try to, for example, a very simple compromise, and it's a form of da'wah which people in the West will salute when they see it, is the shaking of the hand, male and female, shaking of the hand. Sometimes it... you're in conferences, sometimes you're in gatherings and so on, there's all the other religions present, people that are non-believers present, non-Muslims present, and it is a culture or it is the norm amongst them to greet you with a handshake. But to refuse in a polite manner is one of the great forms of da'wah. They say, what is this? You know, when you refuse. And you explain to them in a polite manner, this is, I can't do this because this is from a religious perspective, and explain to them religiously, men are not allowed to touch the hands or the skin of the opposite sex. Strange, but the idea is so strange that it won't leave their minds for a while. They might ponder about it. And mind you, some of them might say, well, it's true. As a woman, I don't like a man to just touch me, shake my hand. You know, this is innate within the female, and soon you will realize that people will say, well, that's more a sober idea than an insane idea. You know, because at the end of the day, people, all of them, they have their ruh is all pure. The origin of the ruh is pure, it's clean. But it's we who contaminate it with all sorts of desires and lusts now. So to compromise the deen sometimes happens. But the da'i should not compromise the deen. He should, whatever he calls to, should be within his whole psyche, in his akhlaq, in his body, and his character. When the people see it, it's there for them to see before they hear it. Before they can hear about Islam, they should see Islam. The manner of greeting, of the manner of walking, the manner of behaving generally, these are all part of the da'i. The second one, that he follow what has been revealed to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is obvious. He follow what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed. In other words, open a book of fiqh and try to acquaint yourself of what is halal for you and what is haram for you. What is makruh, what is not makruh. And this is what a da'i does, or what he should be. That he entrusts his affair to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, as he has guaranteed to aid and assist him. And this is also as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got this guarantee from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So does the da'i. Any da'i that calls unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yatakaffalu bihi, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. يتكفل الله لطالب العلم. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees to the well-being or the welfare of the talib ilm. When you go out to seek knowledge, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eases the path for you. من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله به طريقا إلى الجنة. يعني Allah subhanahu makes his tariq easy in the dunya and in the akhirah. So it is that the caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is faced by trials and great difficulties, but these do not shake his faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the message of truth. He does not fear his enemy, whatever his strength or the size of his alliances may be. But he is constant in seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Very important that the da'i should make it a habit to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for everything. And there's two ways to rely upon it. The first one is sabr, and the second one is the salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, wasta'inu bis-sabri, which is the thing we spoke about earlier, and والصلاه واستعينوا بالصبر والصلاه ان الله يحب الصابرين يا ان الله يحب الصابر ان الله مع الصابرين. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the ones who have patience. So constantly seeking help in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through sabr and the salah. Obviously salah is seeking help in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the salah was the place where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam discussed. It's a private discussion between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the one in charge of every single movement in the world. Now this is why the salah is called mi'raj al-muslim, al-mu'min. He enters into this complete empty space away from the dunya with him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in close contact, spiritual contact. And even when a person is in the salah, your contact is with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as if you are speaking to him. This is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us to say assalamu alayka ayyuha nabi, you know, peace and blessings be upon you, O Prophet, because it's as if you're in there. And when you finish with a conversation, you step out of that conversation, you come back into the world. And then you greet everybody around you, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Because it's only adab when you come out of one room where you've had a discussion out in the open to greet those of men, jinn and angel around you. So the salah is where you let out everything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a place of neediness where you show your poverty, your indigence, your weakness, your submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever you need, lay it in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the salah. Because this is the closest you will get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ سَاجِدُ. The closest place where a person will be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is when he is in sujood. And that sujood is where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left behind blots of tears. As Sayyidah Aisha has described points where he cried and left behind the floor wet of his concern of the ummah. So it shows in this example of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he found no way else to relieve his stress. And what stress, what more stress is there than the stress of a da'i, a true da'i to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a true da'i. The concern of these people, about the people, is far and above the concern of anything in the dunya. Because these are human beings that will face, if they are not turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the divine chastisement, which is the ultimate stress and the ultimate, you know, difficulty that man can ever face. Like a person who came, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke about a person who was in the dunya, had everything to his disposal, one of the richest, one lived in the most luxurious conditions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrects him the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah and asks and shows him, this is your abode, Jahannam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks him, Hal ra'ita khayran qat? Have you ever seen any good in your life? Because of the severity of the min shiddatil hawl, severity of the Jahannam, he says, I've never seen any good in my life. He forgotten all about it at that moment. So these people, it's not our task to see to every single human being in the world. It's just not our task, because shaitan sometimes infiltrating into the minds of us, especially those who are the leading seeds of da'wah. You have to see to every single individual in the world. No. It's not like that. Wherever you have been placed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a community, or in a specific area in a community, or organization or institution in a community, this is your area to work in. Your area to work in. If you're in a classroom, you're not worried about the person sitting over that side of the classroom and neglecting the person on your right side, it's non-Muslim, close by. You have to see to your neighbor first. Your akhlaq, your adab, your manner, share your pen, share this, share that. This is Islam sharing, just, you know, greeting and all of these things. This is your area that you take care of. So that individual da'wah needs to rise up to the level of the public da'wah that is already going on. So we need to care for them. We need to care for them, as we already know as da'is that the abode is very, very, very severe. It's very severe now. And every single person will be asked about those four things that we mentioned in the beginning of this lesson. Now, then, in this, he has the best example, yani alayhi as-salatu wasalam, in the career of the message, message the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and for that reason Allah carried on to say, and in the Messenger of Allah you certainly have the best example for whoever hopes to meet Allah in the last day, and who makes much remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now Allah in the Messengers, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala urges us to see this particular point, that there's no better example, or there's no example greater than the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. The result of this patience was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repelled the disbelievers along with their rage, and they achieved nothing. He fought on behalf of the believers, cast fear in their hearts, the hearts of the enemies' hearts, and expelled them from their fortresses. And this is also the mark of a da'i. If he's sincere, what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obviously, when a person deals with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first when making da'wah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our greatest aid. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in the Quran. The ayah, إِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ عِشْرُونَ صَابِرُونَ يَغْلِبُونَ مِئَتَيْنَ. If there is 20 sabirun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say, this is an ayah that came down in jihad. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say, إِيَّكُمْ مِنْكُمْ عَشْرُونَ مُجَاهِدُونَ. He said, إِيَّكُمْ مِنْكُمْ عَشْرُونَ صَابِرُونَ. If there is 20 sabirun from amongst you, you will overcome 200. So it is not important that the da'i should be in the thousands, but rather the ikhlas has to be in the thousands, in the millions, but they can be one. They can be one. How many one person has made an impact on a community and changed the whole community through his sincerity? This is how a da'i should look at things. And the help obviously comes always from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he is in this state. And this is the golden rule that Shaykh Alawi al-Maliki mentioned right in the beginning. Now, I don't think there's anything else to mention. The ayahs, the ahadith that we wanted to mention, it's all there. And what time is it now? 7 o'clock. One last thing I think I need to mention is it's always been a great source of delight when I hear the examples of previous du'at, like the Sahaba radwanullahu alayhim, how they struggled, and it's the result was not achieved, but they were not bothered because they have struggled for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's it. Sometimes they were successful, sometimes they were not. And I just want to read a few examples before we end off, inshallah ta'ala, just a few of them, inshallah ta'ala, just to get a glimpse of how they also persevered in getting the message across. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one day he called Abdurrahman ibn Auf radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And what did he say to him? He said, Tajahaz fa inni ba'ithuka fi sariya. Get ready, I'm sending you out to some place. They don't ask questions. It's now, سمعًا وطاعةً يا رسول الله. فذكر الحديث وفيه خرج عبد الرحمن. In this particular hadith, عبد الرحمن ابن عوف رضي الله تعالى عنه, he went out حتى لحق بأصحابه فسار حتى قدم دومة الجندل. دومة الجندل is the place he was sent to call the people to Islam. فلما دخلها دعاها إلى الإسلام ثلاثة أيام. When they went there, they called the people to Islam for 3 days. فَلَمَّا كَانَ الْيَوْمَ الثَّالِثِ, the third day, when it was the third day, أَسْلَمَ الْأَصْبَغْ ibn Amr الْكَلْبِيُّ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ. الْأَصْبَغْ ibn Amr الْكَلْبِيُّ, he was a Christian from this particular time, Duma al-Jandal. وَكَانَ رَأْسُهُمْ, and he was the leader of them. فَكَتَبَ عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ, and then عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ wrote back to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, sent with a man. He said, رَجُلٌ مِنْ جُهَيْنَةٍ يُقَالَ لَهُ رَافِ إِبْنُ مُكَيْدٍ إِلَى النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم لِيُخْبِرَهُ. He sent this person with a message, his name was رَافِ إِبْنُ مُكَيْدٍ, to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to inform him. فكتب إليه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم wrote to him. Now obviously this is all in those days. He wrote to him أن تزوج ابنة الأصبغ, to marry the daughter of أصبغ. And when he married the daughter of أصبغ, فتزوجها, he married her, وهي تماضر التي ولدت له بعد ذلك أبا سلمة بن عبد الرحمن. So he married the daughter of Asbah, who was the leader who embraced Islam. And from their marriage came a great Sahabi by the name of Salama, Aba Salama ibn Abdul Rahman, the son of Abdul Rahman. This is one example of how da'wah happened in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because wayfaring is also one of the things that is mentioned under this topic. And the last one I want to mention is very interesting here. But Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent him out to a place in Yemen to give da'wah there. And then Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid, for a period of 6 months, gave da'wah and nothing happened. These people didn't accept Islam. Now this is also very interesting, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said 3 days, and then after that you have to give them the ultimatum, or give them the ultimatum before 3 days of da'wah, and then we have to separate your children and elderly and women from you, and then we'll meet you on the battlefield. Yeah, Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid was very, very good at warfare, very good, excellent. He did not enter into war with the people. Followed the instructions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam strictly. He carried on for 6 months, exceeding the 3 days by far. And then he wrote to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, "Ya Rasulullah, these people don't want to accept." Didn't do anything. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked around and said, "Where's Ali? Get Ali ready. Let him send him out to this people." And Sayyidina Ali was very much older than Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid in Islam, and has gained a great amount of wisdom from Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to say, there's no mu'dila, no difficult situation, except that the only person for it is Ali and Abu Hassan, you know, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So when he came, the Rawi of the Hadith, he said, then Sayyidina Ali came with his men, and they stopped outside this tribe, outside from, you know, at a distance from this tribe, and they prepared for Salah, and they took wudu, and they made Salah publicly in a jama'ah. And the people was like astounded this what they saw, and they came close to witness what this was, just the salah. And with they witnessing the salah, they started asking questions about the salah, and Sayyidina Ali spoke to them, and after he spoke to them, they embraced Islam. And Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu sent to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with a message, and he was extremely happy. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that mission was complete. But then after that, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose Sayyidina Khalid bin Walid again for another mission. You know, the concept here is, it's not that Sayyidina Khalid failed in a mission, so well, let's leave him for the next mission, put him aside, let's take somebody else like Sayyidina Ali. So he was put on a mission again to be sent out, because the thing is, the message that has been given across and has been shared with the person, this is the amal. The result, whether that person becomes a Muslim or not, is not our job. لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من الغير. There's no compulsion in the deen. And I think I will end on that note. For that was the main point that I wanted to get across from this particular section of patience, giving over the message without expecting a result immediately. This is the trueness of a da'i. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Al-Fatiha. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا ولنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. يا ربنا لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك، سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وذنوب والدينا ومشائخنا ولجميع المسلمين أجمعين. ربنا يسر ولا تعسر، ربنا تمم بالخير وأنت يا الله الكريم يسر. اللهم انفعنا ما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا، الحمد لله على كل حال، ونعوذ بالله من حال أهل الضلال برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى، وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، الحمد لله رب العالمين. يا إن شاء الله تعالى، we'll pray, Isha.